One, two, three.
Hello, welcome to Rock the Cash Bar. I'm Ben Mowbray.
And I'm Diane Gallagher.
Every week we pick one song and do a deep dive into the lyrics and explain the different ways they've been interpreted.
We will also discuss how the song connected to us on a personal level, focusing on all the embarrassing details.
Glad to have you here. Enjoy the show. Diane, you want to go roll around in some broken glass?
Always. I'm always ready. Yeah.
Get a little half naked, carve ourselves up a little bit.
Yeah.
Vomit on command.
I can't. I wish I could. Can you?
I can't either. No, I've tried, but if somebody came up to you and say, hey, vomit, do it for us. Find that entertaining?
It's a Gigi Allen type request, right?
It's very much a Gigi Allen type request. We're doing Iggy Pop today.
It's
going to be all kinds of fun and dirty stuff, all kinds of being exposed to viruses and bacteria, and also definitely a lot of pre-pandemic behavior I found in reading about Iggy Pop. Like, you're not going to do a whole lot of that these days.
No.
Jumping into a crowd full of people, fully naked, rubbing your genitals on folks just for fun. When was the last time you did that?
Oh, for fun?
Yeah.
It's been a minute. How about you? Throw these right back to you.
Never. There's so many things that this guy does. Just like, no, that's not for me. But it's weird how that attaches, like in different personalities, right? Like, I think some people watch Iggy Pop and his antics and just go, oh, that could be me if I was just a little bit more free, or if I just learned to play the music, or if I just done a few more push-ups and sit-ups. And then I think there are other people who are just like, no, this is fun to watch, but that's, I could never, ever picture myself doing the things that guy does and would never want to.
What, like, even if you were like really high, I mean, that's a part of it.
Yeah, that is really part of it.
Yeah.
No, I don't think so. Because anytime I've been high, like I find that I find drugs are isolating to me. Like, anytime I've ever done them in public, like, I'm definitely like the withdrawn guy sitting in the corner. Like, I'm not trying to share the show with anybody.
But okay, what about alcohol? Because I've been with you drunk where you broke into the abandoned whorehouse next door and started throwing whorehouse mattresses over the fence to the bar we were at.
I was a young man. I was a
little
young
Iggy.
Man.
A little Iggy.
Some wild things every now and again. I don't think 41-year-old me is going to be breaking into any abandoned whorehouses and throwing mattresses out. But one was sitting right there. We talked about it last week. You can't leave me alone with a stripper pole. And you can't put 25-year-old me next to an abandoned whorehouse and not expect me to go break a window and have a look around.
And throw mattresses over into the bar next door, which I was like, stop touching the mattresses, Ben. Talk about COVID things.
It wasn't just into the bar next door. We also, we need, because there were so many mattresses in that abandoned whorehouse. So many thin, reedy, awful mattresses.
Who was with you? Who was doing that? Who was helping you?
It was Paul Odo.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. I think I was egging him on, and then we just went after it. But yeah, we definitely put whorehouse mattresses in three or four pickup trucks that were in that bar's parking lot. So some
that's
dudes
right.
actually came
that's
home.
Right.
They must have made it all the way home without, what the hell is this?
You said,
I don't even want to touch it. We're gonna have to get a crane in here to lift this mattress out.
Oh my God. Great nights, good times.
Set the truck on fire, honey. I don't know what happened.
They were like small mattresses, like, from my memory, I thought they were like almost like twin size. We're like, please tell me someone wasn't like, well, my kid can sleep on it.
No, I'm sure that didn't happen. These are some really, really unsightly mattresses. So I used to work at this was years ago. This was 16 years ago or longer. I used to work at this bar that was right next to a massage parlor. But it was clearly not a massage parlor. It was absolutely, it was great sport for us, because whenever like guys would always kind of like come up this like little back walkway, there was a, sort of like there was a fence in between the back patio of the bar and this walkway that you would go up and knock on the door to the whorehouse. Mm-hmm. And then it wasn't like a slide pole, like it wasn't quite that romantic, but it was just like I think like the door would open and there would be like a screen door or something like that, and they would look the guy up and down and like you invite him in, and then God knows what happened after that.
You have the password or the secret code.
Yeah, I don't know. All I know is that the place stayed open, and like I couldn't figure out, like, it's obvious, it's right there, they've got a neon sign, like it's clear what's going on here.
Yeah.
But then it got shut down or something happened, but it was obviously had been inactive for weeks. And that's when I got up the courage to go and break in with our friend Paul. And we just went through and just gathered up mattresses. But it was like going through like a horror movie, because there was no lights on in the place. Like the power was completely cut off. And this was before everybody had like cell phone flashlights. So we were just kind of feeling our way around like room to room. And there was no furniture in there other than these rickety tiny beds with the shitty mattresses on them. I don't know what we were looking for, expecting to find, but it was just all kinds of sadness.
That's really sad. Like rats crawling across the...
Yeah. I think buildings have power. I really do think that you can like inject the energy of a place into a room or into a building where it just becomes like the history of what's happened in that place.
Yeah.
Like Ciro's in the Comedy Store are probably the best examples of that.
Yeah.
But, I mean, obviously you can go to like castles and things in England and Europe that have that feeling, but I have never been in a building in America that gave me the creeps quite as much as that night that we went in there. It was just like, cause you just look around and just go, oh God, what's happened here?
There was like a joy but no joy given in these rooms.
Absolutely no joy. I worked in another bar downtown, and every bar downtown apparently, because they have these Houston history tours, mm-hmm. and the guy that does the tour, like every single bar claims, oh, this used to be Sam Houston's favorite whorehouse. And Sam Houston must have been a lusty guy, because there's half a dozen bars downtown that used to be Sam Houston's favorite whorehouse. But I worked in one. And you'd have to go up like the back steps at night to let yourself. And that's apparently where that was the private entrance where men would go up in like the old Wild West, like 1860s days. And when I would have to go up there alone at 3:30 in the morning, it really gave me the creeps, because I couldn't stop my imagination from thinking about all the people who would come up these stairs and what they did. And then, not to be too sad about it, but all the people who walked up those stairs never walk back down, because there must have been some of that going on, which it kind of leads you down the life of Iggy Pop.
Okay. I
mean, he's a hardcore drug guy, did a lot of LSD, a lot of cocaine, a lot of heroin, a lot of booze, like so many other rock stars did. Like they walked up those stairs, and a lot of them never walked back down.
Right.
But Iggy is still up there alive and kicking, hale and healthy, like you wouldn't believe. He's healthy as a horse. Yeah, but everything is spinning.
So I told Corbin, like, he loves Iggy so much and Jeremy loves Iggy. And I was like, I am so scared we're going to disappoint you, because they know more, I think, than we do, just generally without research. Yeah. And I was like, I hope I don't disappoint you with this. And Corbin's like, you're not going to disappoint me. The only thing that you have to just make sure you say is that at 70 years old, Iggy Pop is more of a badass and healthier than anyone listening right now.
Yeah. A 70-year-old Iggy Pop is more than welcome to take his shirt off in public in a way that 40-year-old me is not, and 23-year-old me also was not.
Exactly.
Somehow he can maintain it. And he's a really blunt guy. Like somebody asked him, like, how did you, even in the face of all the drugs and booze that you were putting in, how did you maintain your physique? And he was just like, I was just, my treadmill was a little different than other people's. It was just like, it was drugs, steroids, the gym.
Wow. Okay, I'll do that. drugs, steroids, at the gym. That sounds like a chant. Drugs, steroids, the gym. Drugs, steroids, the gym. All right, then.
It's like you haven't done, it's like, imagine that being your personal trainer. Like you got to do your heroin, it's time for your steroids. Now, drop and give me 100 push-ups.
only pulled off 50, here's some math.
I picked Lust for Life, which is like it's Iggy's biggest hit, maybe next to Real Wild Child.
Right.
But I felt kind of weird, like sifting through the Iggy songs, like trying to like which one of these do I want to do? It's like the only answer is Lust for Life, because there's so much going on in that song.
Yeah.
Like it's the song that brought his career back to life. It's the song that introduced me to him. And it's all, there's just so many different weird details going on in this one. Everybody knows it as the title song, the lead soundtrack for Trainspotting.
That
movie came out when I was 16 years old. I went to that, just a couple of years before I had my mind like thoroughly blown by Pulp Fiction in the movie theater. So I was well into being a movie geek. I went to go see Trainspotting, and it did almost the same thing to 16-year-old me that Pulp Fiction had done a few years ago.
Yeah.
But have you been back to watch Trainspotting? When's the last time you watched it?
Don't tell me, like, since it came out, don't tell me it doesn't hold up.
Oh, no, it holds up.
Okay.
It just holds up, at least for me, in a completely different way.
Oh.
Like, I remember watching it as a kid and just being just thrilled by it. It was a sugar rush. It was all these exciting things. You know, it's a group of four friends that are off doing dangerous stuff. They're robbing people for drugs. They're having sex with ladies, which is a thing I really wanted to do when I was 16. And the music's crazy, and the movie's just unbelievably fast paced, and it's introducing me to all these things I'd never considered, and it's set in Scotland, which is a place I'd been to, so some of the bar rooms smelled a little familiar to me. It was just so exciting. But I go back and watch it now, and it's a tragedy from back to front, from top to bottom, from start to finish. It's just heartbreaking. Like, I just can't. Are
you watching them like you're their father now?
Yeah.
boys. No.
Simmer down, boys.
Yeah.
But it's really kind of scary because it reminds me that I'm probably past the emotional place where I could ever create something like Trainspotting that would resonate the way that it does, because I'm too afraid of pushing the envelope like that. You know, I don't want anybody to get hurt anymore. You know, it's like I'm into caretaker mode, I suppose. Which is a little bizarre. Like, I gotta let go of that art side of me. Anyway, let's get into the lyrics. Here we go.
Okay. All right.
I can't wait to do it. This is Lust for Life by Iggy Pop. Here comes Johnny Yen again with the liquor and drugs and the flesh machine. He's going to do another strip tease. So he's just getting right to it.
Yeah.
Like, it's just,
we know where we are.
Yeah. Like, things are getting wild. For the longest time, it wasn't until I started like doing the research on this song this week, I thought the lyrics were "Here comes Johnny in again."
So did I.
It's Johnny Yen. It's a specific character. There's a dispute about it, though. Johnny Yen is a character in William S. Burroughs' novel, The Ticket That Exploded.
Right.
Which I read as a 15 or 16 year old kid.
I was going to ask, you're such a literary guy. Like, I was like, does Ben already know this book?
I knew the book. Okay. Now, but this was when I was like, obviously I'm a pretentious prick. We've got like 100 episodes in the bag that prove nothing other than that. But when I was a kid, me and my friends used to go to, this little bookstore, and we'd steal some books that we wanted, but we'd also steal some books that we could go sell for cigarette money. Yeah. One of those, I really got into like Jack Kerouac and William Burroughs because Michael Stipe was really into Jack Kerouac and William Burroughs. So I read them all, but I didn't really understand them. And so I read The Ticket That Exploded, and nothing stayed in my head. I just I just like sitting there in my resale shop clothes with my silly hat on, reading my William S. Burroughs book and taking myself very seriously.
It's a whole vibe and a whole look.
Yep.
You wanted to be.
But it didn't register. But there's two schools of thought about Johnny Yen. One is that he's the character from The Ticket That Exploded, and that's what Iggy Pop says.
That's what Iggy says.
Yeah. So you got to take it at face value for that. But Ray Manzarek of The Doors, whose memory maybe you can't rely upon.
Maybe suspect. I would think,
yeah, Ray Manzarek has flossed his brain with enough acid that it could be weird. But he says that Johnny Yen was actually a guy named Gypsy Johnny, who was a heroin dealer in Laurel Canyon in the early 70s up to the late 80s. Now, that was Laurel Canyon. That's when all the rock stars were moving up there. Mm-hmm. This is like peak Eagles those days. But he's also kind of a figure in the Wonderland murders.
Oh, interesting. Mm-hmm. You know what? I understand why it can't be both.
It could be. There's no reason why it can't be.
And Iggy's like, well, I just won't be public with that part of it, but it was a perfect character to be both. Yeah.
Yeah. And it makes a good bit of sense too, because there are some parallels between Iggy Pop and John Holmes, who's kind of become the central character of the Wonderland murders.
Right.
There was an article in Rolling Stone that they published just a couple of months ago. It was a long piece about John Holmes's involvement in the Wonderland murders,
right,
which they didn't write for any kind of specific reason other than the fact that it's going to get some clicks. Porn stars, brutal killings, drugs, write it up. I mean, 900 words.
There's a great podcast called Time Suck with Dan Cummins, which, I mean, it's very popular. A lot of people listen to it. And I listened to that episode, the John Holmes Wonderland murders. Pretty good. Pretty good.
Very, very scary stuff.
Yeah.
Don't get caught up in liquor and drugs seems to be the story behind that one. Anyway, let's move on.
I did, and I'm okay. Some people get through it.
I made it through my drug days without being beaten to death with a lead pipe. I think I did good.
You did good.
It's an achievement. I'm going to stop feeling bad about myself.
There you go.
Hey man, where'd you get that lotion? I've been hurting since I bought the gimmick about something called love. Yes, something called love. So it gets worse. Like, yeah. It starts off, you take those two couplets. Here comes Johnny Yen again with the liquor and drugs in his flesh machine. He's going to do to the stripsies. And then it's like, there's like a bit of shock and revulsion. It's like, you're almost happy to see, here comes Johnny Yen again. But then all of a sudden it's just like, oh fuck, he's getting weirder.
Well, yeah, and so, and the hypnotizing chickens, like, if I didn't do any research and I'm just going through the lyrics, I'm like, what? Like, I'm so lost. But then I found out that the book that you're talking about, the ticket that exploded, this is specifically from that book. He said the hypnotizing chickens, the drugs and the striptease and the liquor, that's all like direct references from that book specifically.
Yeah, it's all lifted specifically out of it. There's a lot of things, like the title, Lust for Life, is the title of the song. Is drawn from I think it's a 1956 movie starring Kirk Douglas. It's all about the life of Vincent Van Gogh.
Yeah, it's an adaptation of Irving Stone's 1934 biographical novel about the Dutch painter Vincent Van Gogh, called Lust for Life, which I'm going to go see the immersive Van Gogh, by the way, next week.
Ooh, I want to go see that really badly.
Yeah.
My mom and dad and my sister went to go see it last night. They were sending me videos like, that looks fantastic.
Was it as good as it
looked? Can I find some mushrooms? Yes. Would it be polite to go, could I maintain myself?
Yeah.
See, that's the other thing. That's how I know I'm old. Like when I was in my early 20s and something like that came along, I'd be like, yeah, let's go eat some mushrooms and go to that. Now I'm just like, don't scare anybody. Don't go and be weird. Like, I know you just want to go and bliss out, but can you really trust yourself to do that? Well, that's like hypnotizing chickens. That's my favorite line in the song.
I know.
Well, I'm just a modern guy. Of course, I've had it in my ear before because of a lust for life. Well, that's like hypnotizing chickens. Well, I'm just a modern guy. Of course, I've had it in my ear before because of a lust for life. This song was written in cahoots with David Bowie. So it's Bowie's gender bending, which is different from Iggy's kind of more aggressive gender bending.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Where it seemed like Bowie seemed to be like just looking for the right to be a beautiful man or be a beautiful, you know, gender bending man. Iggy Pop was kind of demanding it. Like he'd go to his show and he would literally jump off the stage and hump boys and girls.
Yeah.
He didn't really care. And of course, with his big, raw Michigan man physique, he was probably, you know, an intimidating presence. There's plenty of stories of Iggy Pop getting knocked out, you know, as he jumped into the crowd. But he still has that aggression that Bowie doesn't have, which I think makes him,
Bowie's like this weird, like, conservative, androgynous man. But, like almost like you can look but don't touch, where Iggy's like, I want to roll around in all of you.
Yeah, you can touch, I can touch, we can all touch. That seems to be Iggy Pop's sort of mantra with the thing. But they both have that, it's almost like they're demanding the space. You know, and this is the early 70s, so that line, well, I'm just a modern guy, is kind of an invite and a kiss off in a way, don't you think? Where they're just saying like this is normal. Like it's almost kind of, and it can be kind of accusatory in a little way when you think of how confrontational Iggy Pop's performances could be.
Yeah.
And if he's got somebody in the crowd going, why are you doing this? What the fuck? Get away from me. Like, I'm just a modern guy.
This is what, of course, you're the one who's being weird.
Before. Yeah. I've always thought, that line is kind of a two-edged sword, or at least to me. Maybe I'm a bit of a pervert, but of course I've had it in my ear before. It's just like, look, I've heard all of your complaints about me and my behavior. I've heard them. And I don't give a shit.
Right.
But I also wonder if, look, I've had it everywhere, including my ear.
Every last hole. What am I doing?
Yes. Do we need to get more specific? No, I don't think we need to. I was thinking about Train Spotting, or thinking what little I knew about Iggy's life when I first heard this song. But the very first time I heard the song, I thought, of course, I've had it in my ear before, meant I've had sex every single way you can think of, and a lot of ways you can't think of.
Being, yeah, very metaphorical about every hole. Yeah, I mean, again, it can be both, and I think he meant you to hear it however you want to hear it.
I'm worth a million in prizes. What I love about Iggy Pop is he's kind of similar to Kurt Cobain in a way that, like, all of his lyrics could be the title of his biography. Worth a million in prizes, the passenger, you know, candy, real wild child, all of that stuff. Like Cobain is exactly the same way, you know, soaked in bleach, here we are now, entertain us. Uh-huh. It's just, and there's documentaries about both men that are all titled, you know, those things, like those, you can't miss. Like, their focus is not necessarily like
lyrics is they're just all pull quotes for your life.
Yeah, and it's like they don't necessarily have to make sense. They don't have to tell a story, but they do have to be very, very exciting. Taking it, it's almost like they know, because they've been through it themselves. Like, they're like, I am writing words for kids to scribble in their notebooks while they're ignoring their teachers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's the fun
stuff. I'm worth a million in prizes is a great one. I'm worth a million in prizes with my torture films. Drive a GTO, wear a uniform. All on a government loan. So he's awesome and he's not working for any of it.
I love like the backstory that, like, you know, honestly, reading about Iggy, I was like, we have a lot in common. Me and Iggy, we're very much the same. Like, he's an only child. He grew up in a trailer park. So did I for a few years. I love the story he talks about. I saw this interview where he said his neighbors, like, were from Tennessee, like a few trailers down, and they would asphyxiate chickens on their tailpipe to kill them and cook them for dinner. Where I was like, woo, that's a little more trailer than I had, but. and then, you know, I've performed topless. I haven't. I'm just kidding. I was just trying to make a list of three things me and Iggy had in common. It's just the two things.
Eating asphyxiated chickens. That's fun because it's like a mixture of like that's the urban poor and the rural poor.
Yeah.
Like the rural poor, you know how to kill chickens. I've seen it happen. I can't do it myself, but I watched a guy at a farm near where I grew up just do that quick thing, and he was good at it. Did it hundreds of times in a row. I'm like, holy living crap.
A chicken, that's how I'd want to go. I do not want to be asphyxiated on a tailpipe.
No, I guess, I mean, I don't want to, okay, let's not think about it too much. I guess you put them in a garbage bag and then wrap that around the tailpipe.
And you're eating poison chicken.
Smoked chicken, Diane. Industrial smoked chicken.
All right.
Enjoy your carbon monoxide cordon bleu. Yeah, I'm worth a million in prizes. I'm through with sleeping on the sidewalk. No more beating my brains. No more beating my brains with the liquor and drugs. So this song was written in the mid-1970s. Iggy had been a rock and roller and kind of a semi-famous guy. He was famous around Detroit and around Michigan, and really famous in rock circles for being sort of this rock and roll god, like this aspirational thing that even guys like Bowie wanted to be. Like, he just had this animal magnetism, but he had no band around him. Like, he's a strange character. Like, Jim Osterberg is his name, and his parents were teachers. So they weren't making a whole lot of money, but they wanted to make sure that Jim got a good education. So they moved into this trailer park that was in a good school district. It was the best place that they could afford to do it. So Jim was actually a fairly serious guy who was raised by serious people, but he got super into music and he was a drummer.
Yeah.
Like, that was his thing. That was the one thing that he was really, really excited about. And he was studying musical theory. He was reading about the blues and reading about all different genres of music, and he would travel around. Like, he lived in Michigan, but he traveled to Chicago to look for this very specific blues man that he had seen come through, and he wanted, you know, tips on how to play it. I listened to an interview. The blues man himself has since passed, but his wife is still around. So they interviewed his wife, and she was saying that she's like, there were plenty of young musicians that used to come around to see my husband, but they were all white boys. Like, no black boys would come around to learn about this music. It was just all white people trying to, like, how do you do that? How do you learn to do it? Yeah. So Iggy Pop goes to see this guy, and he's very, very nice to him. Like, he invites him into the house. He shows him. He gives him some advice. But then Jim Osterberg kind of goes away, and he says, he travels home, And he goes, I got high and I sat in a meadow and I thought about it and I came to the epiphany that I'm not black. I don't need to be playing black music.
It was like, an epiphany.
Yeah, like you're absolutely right.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So that's when he came up with this idea of white delinquent blues, which is what he wanted to play. So he was working at a record store, and there were these two brothers, the Ashton brothers, that were even more delinquent than Jim Osterberg at the time. Like these guys were just stoners, apparently, just like absolute dropouts. So that's who he gets together with, and he starts writing songs like No Fun. Like there's nothing to do. It's 1969, okay? And they just play that riff over and over and over again. And that's what Iggy wanted. Like he was musical enough to know that that wasn't going to cut it. That's not going to impress Led Zeppelin. That's not going to impress Eric Clapton, but that's not what he's trying to do. Like he's trying to write this really rootsy, bluesy kind of music that he'd seen in black communities, but it's just like, I want to do that, you know, in my downtrodden white community. Like I want to find guys who
don't try to copy something that's not his life.
Yeah. Like just find guys who basically learn to play themselves or guys that I'll teach to play music. And, you know, we'll play this really, really basic form of rock and roll that he kind of dubbed
the root of punk rock fucking music.
There it is. Yeah. One crazy dude from Michigan. So he's beaten his brains with the liquor and drugs. Like, he'd been that way for years, but he starts working The MC5 is actually a pretty big band around Detroit at this time. The Stooges, as they came to be, but I heard so many different stories of why they're called the Stooges.
Yeah.
My favorite is they had their landlord was a guy who was he seems like a nice older guy who's just like, I'm going to try to help out these artsy kids. So he gives them, you know, a place to stay. And apparently this guy he was older. He's not feeling well. So he asks Iggy for a glass of water one night when they're all drunk and stoned. So Iggy just pees in a cup and hands it to his landlord. So his landlord just throws it at him and just says, you and your fucking stooges, get the fuck out of here. That's one story.
Is that the one you want it to be?
That's the one that I want it to be. Yeah, but I don't think it's the one that
I don't think that's it, but yeah. I get
it. What was the one you read?
Let me find it. Hold on. Crap, put me on the spot. My notes are so long on this one. And that's why I told Corbin, I was like, I'm so scared. Like there's just too much. There's too much on Iggy. Hold on, that I got the name Pop. Oh, you know what I'm focusing on? He got the name Pop because he once shaved his eyebrows for a show, making him look like a friend with the last name Pop, who had recently undergone chemotherapy and was eyebrowless himself. So that's where the Pop came from. I didn't write down the Stooge thing. I'd read a bunch of different stories, but that's the only one I wrote down. It's like how we got the Pop. All right.
Yeah. Now there's another one where the Ashton brothers were saying, it's just like, hey, we're like the Three Stooges. Like we're not trying to bother anybody, but everybody hates us. We'll just call ourselves the Stooges.
Okay.
So I don't really like that one. Like it can't just be named after the Three Stooges. I don't like that.
No. Okay.
Where are we? We're almost done with the lyrics. It says, okay. it goes, well, here comes Johnny Yen again with his liquor and drugs and a flesh machine. He's going to do another strip tease. As, hey man, where'd you get that lotion? Your skin starts itching once you buy the gimmick about something called love.
Yeah.
So this song is written in Berlin. A couple of years, like Iggy goes in, he becomes like a local rock star. And he makes friends with the MC5 and a couple of different venues. And he's such a force. He's just such a rock and roll force of personality that it doesn't really matter that his band can't play that well or that he's, you know, showing up, you know, on drugs and drunk and sometimes can't get through gigs. He's such a spectacle that it works for the rock and roll crowd. And he ends up opening for very, very big acts that are coming through. Like they open for Cream in early 70s coming through, or the late 60s, early 70s. Yeah. Like it's insane. So he's meeting guys like Clapton and his reputation grows and grows. And eventually, Bowie hears about him and sees like the famous Iggy Pop pictures. I don't know if it was before or after the famous 1970 night in Cincinnati. It's like the most famous picture in rock and roll of like Iggy used to crowd surf. That was his thing.
He's
the godfather of it. Yeah. So he would jump into the crowd and they would hold him up, or sometimes they would just let him. He was opening for a band that hated him. They just they didn't like the Stooges, didn't want them on the bill or anything like that. And it was a known in those days. I guess you read, you know, the magazines or whatever. So he's opening for this band and their crowd hates him. You know, they know that their heroes don't like this Iggy Pop guy. So he does his jumping into the crowd thing and they just part and let him land on the stadium floor. Well, Iggy's Iggy. So he just gets himself back up, gets back on stage. And a few songs later, he does it again and they do it again. So he just does two full on face plants, apparently, in the middle of the show. Just absolute collapsing down on it. So he's a bit of a bruiser, a bit of a tough guy.
I love that, like, you know what? Do it again.
Apparently he got that idea from, he was watching Bob Dylan in the mid 60s, like shortly after Dylan had gone electric, you know, that whole controversy. Mm-hmm. Like it wasn't just at that, is it the, you know, the folk festival where he famously, you know, played electric for the first time and everybody booed and hated him. Yeah. I guess that whole tour afterwards, he was, every city he went to, he was electric. He got the boo, you're a sellout.
Oh, God, people are
they really are. But I mean, there was that division then, you know, like there, like the Beatles and the Rolling Stones were coming out with their electric music and all that stuff. And the idea was that a guy like Dylan, who'd been a folk, he was going to stick to it and his Woody Guthrie roots.
Right.
But he was changing with the times because he famously said the times they are a changing.
They are a changing.
Yeah. But apparently Iggy Pop was at a Bob Dylan show and he watched Bob Dylan take all those boos and watched him just not give a damn about it. And that's when Iggy Pop went, okay, sometimes holding the stage means holding it against their wrath.
Yeah. Mm. I just love that kind of like confidence for people who invent a whole thing, just being themselves. Makes me.
Yeah, I love the confidence when they're great at it, but like,
I mean, it's a very important distinction.
Yeah. But I've been the comic in a couple of bars in a couple of different towns where you're just like, they're not into you. They don't want this. Right. And it's, you know, like I've been up there for a half an hour just forcing myself on people. And it's not a good feeling. It's not a good feeling.
Well, those are the people who aren't self-aware. They're so into the fantasy of themselves. They're not paying attention to the reaction, you know?
Yeah. To whether this is entertaining or not. Mm-hmm. Like I remember especially early, but obviously it happened all the way through. Otherwise I'd still be doing stand-up, but there was definitely nights where it's just up there, just like, okay, just hold the stage. Like you're not getting the reaction you want at all. You're not effectively doing the job at all. And you just feel like shit, but but you still have to hang in there.
I loved your antics. One of my favorite, and I have a photo of it, is I walked upstairs at Rudyard's and it wasn't an open mic. It was before Rudyard's had an open mic. It was a real show. And I walked upstairs and I could hear your voice, but all I saw was the microphone cord going all the way from the floor to the, into the ceiling. And I was like, in the fucking ceiling? You had crawled up there like a rat and you were sitting in the rafters doing your show from the ceiling. I ran up to the stage and took a picture of you up there with like your microphone. I was like, this is the best thing I've ever seen. What made that you night was that?
It was two things. I think I had like a new thing that I've been working on all that day, and like the opening part of it hadn't worked out. And I was like, I like did the Krusty the Clown thing. We're just like, this goes on for another 15 minutes. But then it was also like the Bono climbing the speaker stacks thing. Like I wanted to do that. So I just hopped up on the stool and I was tall enough to jump up to the rafters. And hoisted myself up from there.
And I could never do. I'd have to do the joke that everybody did at Rudyard's, is like that, there was that window right next to the stage that went all the way to the floor, and you just want to jump out of it.
Yep. Somebody's gonna do that one day. That's mostly the end of the lyrics to that one. But
yeah.
Oh, your skin starts itching once you buy the gimmick. So he was trying to kick drugs. He obviously he was spiraling out of control. The Stooges had collapsed after having just brief, more or less, you know, like local success. They were kind of this legendary band, but because of their boozing and their drugs, they couldn't get it together. So he was even taking in Iggy's head, like, I got to get cleaned up if I can actually come close to fulfilling my dreams. Somewhere along the way, he got a message from somebody who knew David Bowie saying, hey, Bowie wants to meet you. So they met at a bar in New York and apparently hit it off very well. You know, they're both into cocaine, they're both a little androgynous. I'm sure they had lots of fun. But Iggy checks himself into the UCLA Neuropsychiatric Treatment Center in 1974. And so he's trying to kick. And then a few days later, David Bowie shows up with his entourage and as Bowie puts it, a whole bunch of drugs. We figured he hadn't had drugs in a couple of days. He might need a few more. But and this, again, another Bowie quote, he just goes, but this was very definitely a leave your drugs at the door kind of hospital.
Got it. So yeah, so, that's what I remember reading. And this is the time where he actually cut his hair short because he thought that's what like straight people did. Is they
yeah. And it was probably like one of those things that addicts do or that you try to do when you're taking the first steps to clean up your life. It's like, okay, let's just do something dramatic. I'm going to cut my hair. I'm going to get a tattoo. I'm changing my wardrobe. Like it seems like that. Like I'm trying to leave the wild man behind. Yeah. So both Bowie and Iggy decide that that's what they need to do. So they picked Berlin as the place to go in because they both had, it was cocaine and uppers that were the thing for them. So they went to Berlin, not realizing as they joked about it, that it's basically the heroin capital of Europe. So they find themselves basically surrounded by drugs there. But I think that's where that line comes from, that like your skin starts scratching. It's like they're both in there trying to kick and they're both doing a fairly good job of it. I mean, they're still wild childs, but they're staying off of it.
This song, like, it's really about like that lust for life you get when you're trying to get clean and like feeling like, you know, the lust for actual life, not life on drugs.
It could very well be because he does have a different character. It's like, here comes Johnny Yen again. Like you could make the argument that Iggy Pop is kind of referencing himself.
That's what I think it is. He's like writing about what he was like, but like he's actually trying to have an actual lust for life without the drugs.
Yeah. Yeah. He's trying to set himself free.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think there's no doubt about that.
Did you read I don't know if you were getting to it because they're in Berlin, about like how they got the inspiration for the first like beats of the song?
Yeah, it's fascinating.
So, I was like, really? I tried to go online and try to hear. So do you want to explain it, the AFN inspiration?
Yeah. So it's Iggy Pop and David Bowie, and they're living it up in Berlin. They're partying, they're enjoying themselves, but they're trying to stay clean. But there's wild, wild stories of them in Berlin. But every week, their ritual was to watch Starsky and Hutch on the Armed Forces TV network.
Yeah.
It's Germany. Obviously, there's American Armed Forces networks, you know, all over the place.
Right.
But just the idea of Iggy Pop and David Bowie, like having an appointment date, like we're watching Starsky and Hutch.
Isn't that funny? it's so relatable, though.
David Bowie doing, and both of them, but David Bowie especially, just doing anything normal is just so alarming to think about. Like, can you imagine him just like in his pajama bottoms, having an orange juice, watching Starsky and Hutch? No.
No, or changing a diaper, or, everything he does has to be Bowie.
Yeah. What kind of toothpaste does David Bowie use? It's not going to be Colgate. Mm-hmm. It's got to be some kind of special Indian soap sort of.
Yeah, does he make boring ham and cheese sandwiches and just eat them with chips? Yeah. Sandwich.
He's got all kinds of varieties of chutneys.
Yeah, so they were watching that and they said, let's see, AFN would broadcast an ID when they came on the air, a representation of a radio tower, and it made a signal sound like beep, 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 beep. And him and Bowie both were like, yep, we're going to take that. And Bowie grabbed a ukulele and started playing it.
That to me was the most amazing thing about this song. Like it started with a ukulele.
Yes. Yes.
It started with an episode of Starsky and Hutch, Armed Forces Network, and a ukulele. And now that's the other fascinating thing about this song. It wasn't a big hit when it was first released. Like it was a kind of a known commodity amongst music people. But Iggy Pop had a quote, which was just like, when I wrote that song, I thought everybody in America was going to be rocking to this motherfucker. And it took 20 years. And he said, because there's a system that wouldn't give me a chance. And I outlived that system.
Ah, that's a good quote.
It is a really good quote.
So was it Trainspotting that broke it back into the...
It was released as a single off of the Trainspotting soundtrack, and it went to like number 24 or something in the UK charts in like 1996, 20 years after it had been released. And that's where I found it. Like I never would have heard of Iggy Pop if not for the Trainspotting soundtrack. And I thought, because of the way, I don't think I would have. Like I knew real well, I would have found it eventually. I guess 16-year-old me didn't know about Iggy Pop.
Okay.
Like obviously it would have come around, I think. But he's on that soundtrack, but the way that he's sort of addressed in that movie, like they talk about him in that. It's like Iggy Pop is still on tour. You know, I saw him in Edinburgh last year or something like that. Like,
yeah.
I presume that because of that, that Iggy Pop must be Scottish. I didn't know he was American.
Until
much, much later. I figured he was just this wild drug addicted Scotsman, and that's why the Trainspotting guys loved him, but nope.
Sometimes in the way he sings, he doesn't sound American. I don't know if he's throwing his voice like that on purpose, but yeah, that's easy to understand why you would think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think he's vamping a bit, but that what also amazes me about Iggy Pop is how he's an eyelash away from being truly terrible. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like laughably awful. Like speaking of the Wonderland Murders, and like some of Iggy Pop's songs are just this close to being like Mark Wahlberg in Boogie Nights. Like they're that close to feel my
Yeah, needs. I know what you're getting at. God, that's such a funny scene in Boogie Nights when you have to be a musician. Mark Wahlberg can nail cringeworthy characters.
Yes, he can.
Oh, so good. I feel that way with like Iggy's very versatile to me, and like I think for the longest time I didn't know that he sang Candy, like because that just is, it's almost like very 80s, like candy, like I don't know, it just doesn't, I didn't know for the longest time if that was Iggy. I thought it was just some other like new wave group.
I can understand that. He does have a versatility to him, and of course they're hugely different. Like even songs on the same album, like Lust for Life, seems like this guy's a real wild man. Yeah. And then you listen to The Passenger, and it's just like he's just a little bit more introspective. So do I. Mm-hmm. So do I.
And but I this love, is also love Susie and the Banshees when they do it.
Yeah.
It's all good, but yeah. Okay.
And I ride. So many crazy Iggy Pop stories. I don't even know where to. There's the famous. So he's on stage, all of them are basically, so he's on stage and then he jumps into the crowd.
Like yeah, exactly. I have a fun fact. Were you heading somewhere with that?
Nope.
This blew my mind. It's something I'm so glad didn't happen. When Jim Morrison died, Iggy was considered to be the replacement in the Doors. The remaining Doors decided to continue as a trio, so it never materialized. And I think that would have been the worst motherfucking idea, because I hate the Doors.
Yeah, that would have been terrible.
I don't like the Doors, and I'm so glad that didn't become his path, you know?
Yeah. I'm amazed at how the Doors have disappeared. I don't know if we've talked about it before, but it like used to be you would go into any head shop, like obviously, you know, I'm way younger than the Doors fans, but you would walk into a head shop in the 90s and there'd be nothing but Jim Morrison t-shirts.
Well, because like, right it's a movie, and you know, Val Kilmer nailed that. He really, really did. But yeah, I mean, he had this like comeback that was just everywhere for a while, especially in the 90s.
And then he vanished again. Mm-hmm. Like it was really kind of strange. Like, I don't think kids are you know, buying Doors albums anymore. They're certainly not buying Doors t-shirts.
Doesn't have staying power to me.
That's what it is.
People hate it. I mean, the Doors are very polarizing. You either fucking love them or you don't like them at all. I don't see there's any like mediocrity, like in the middle there.
Yeah.
It's not into it. It's not into
it. No. Like I said, whoa, weird confluence. Val Kilmer played Jim Morrison and Val Kilmer played John Holmes in Wonderland.
Ooh.
Val Kilmer's all over this episode.
Have you seen the documentary about him?
No, I want to see it really, really badly. It's
insanely good.
Yeah, I bet it is crazy good. Because he was obsessive. He was there's that documentary, and then there's a documentary about the lead singer of Blind Melon that sound very, very similar. Ooh. And that they both had like, we kind of forget about it now because we all have cameras and Instagram. We're all recording ourselves. But that was a kind of a strange thing to do. Like people would buy camcorders and they would film like every moment of their life. And yeah. Val Kilmer was like that. And so was, I'm sorry, Shannon.
Punky Brewster was too. So Leigh Moonfried, did you see her documentary? It's all of her footage of when she was young. I can't remember the name of it. But she was involved in so many scenes of like kids that were popular like in the 90s that died. And there's all this footage of her hanging out with them. Like the guys, remember that movie Kids? Like she got really involved with like the skate scene and all of those guys and like all these, and River Phoenix and all these people. And she has all this footage of just them young and partying. And like, it's about like her life and like, you know, what came of it, but it's very good.
Yikes. I'm glad they did it, but it must have been really bizarre to be around those people in like the late 80s and early 90s when they're like, put the camera away. I think in the Val Kilmer documentary, there's a couple of scenes where like guys like Sean Penn are just like, okay, Val, enough. And enough.
That's enough. Yeah. What's bad is I think I would have been that person, because I'm that person now and I'm not famous. Like I have an obsession, and I've always had it with documenting my life. Like I had a diary that I started in fifth grade, and it went nonstop through like the middle, like early 20s. I mean, it was like a compulsion obsession with like documenting every single part of my life every day.
Yeah.
And it might just be an addiction thing. I don't know, but like, I get it. Like people were like, "Hi, can you stop?" And I'm like, "No, I can't." I just can't.
I had a similar thing, but it was with writing. Like I always wanted to write about what I'd felt or characters that I met. Like I would there was a time in my life where I would meet, you know, another guy that I thought was just like, okay, you're a fascinating, strange character who comes from a place I barely understand. And I would write vignettes and things about what I imagined their life was like. And the whole idea was that hopefully eventually it would, you know, inform a novel down the road. Like I definitely wanted to document and record myself, because I was like, it's going to take all of this if I'm actually going to write something that's worth anybody's time.
You know what? When you're 70, I think you're going to do it.
Yeah, we'll see. We will see. So Iggy jumps off the stage one day, no doubt. And apparently he comes back, and his keyboardist says that it looks like he's been stabbed, but really badly this time. He says it's like there's flesh falling off him. So he helps him back up on stage. And it turns out somebody had just like pressed a peanut butter and jelly sandwich into his chest.
What? Wait a minute. Who has I brought my peanut butter and jelly sandwich to the punk rock show.
That's what I've always wondered about, like in the cartoons when they start throwing tomatoes and eggs. Like who brought rotten tomatoes to the show? Like just in case.
On a farm.
How do they get into the venue? Like that's just bad bouncing.
The ladies' handbags. I think about, like, you know, I'm going to the punk rock show, mom, and she's like, do you want me to make you a sandwich? And then he did. He got really hungry.
You gotta keep your energy up for the mosh pit, son.
You're gonna need a snack. Here's an Uncrustable. That's really funny. Why was there a peanut butter and jelly sandwich there? That's awesome.
There was a night at Max's Kansas City in New York, which is the big, that's where he crosses paths with Andy Warhol and all his gang, and probably Bowie as well. He jumps off the stage and he's standing on a table, and the table collapses.
Yeah.
And he falls down into all the broken glass. And as he's getting up onto the stage, he realizes that he's cut very badly, but he also sees an opportunity. Yep. And he's able to contort himself in such a way, because keep in mind, he's been cut in the abdomen and the chest and the arms so many times, and he knows how this works. He's able to contort himself in such a way that he gets a massive blood spurt of blood, like all over the crowd. That's a lovely story. Mm-hmm. Gets rushed to the hospital by Alice Cooper.
No, what?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Can you imagine being in a room full of people, you're bleeding very badly, and the only person who, like Andy Warhol's there? You think Andy Warhol, with his, you know, maternalistic, let's build a community kind of thing, he might have somebody. You think Andy Warhol would have somebody on hand who's like, you know, like Baby Driver. Like,
yeah.
Anytime somebody needs to be taken to the hospital, that's your job.
Yeah.
Didn't happen. It fell to Alice Cooper to be the responsible man in the room.
How old is Alice Cooper at this point? Do you have like an idea?
This is 1974, I think. So
he's Alice not older, Cooper. Much older than all of them.
No, but he's just like, again, what a strange scene. Like as weird as Iggy Pop and David Bowie watching Starsky and Hutch is, I think Iggy Pop slowly bleeding out in the passenger seat as Alice Cooper is speeding to the hospital. So it's a little more logical, but still a little surreal. I found I don't know if you heard this story. I was listening to a podcast that had it on. So thanks very much to the Year of Iggy podcast.
Oh.
He was in line to be drafted into the Vietnam War. Like when they first like really started ramping up, you know, the draft numbers, and it looked like for sure Iggy's draft age. He's not in college. Like, how are you going to get out of this? There was a manager of nightclubs and bands around the Detroit area who gathered up all of his musicians who were likely to be drafted. And they were all getting called in for their interview, you know, around the same day. So he got them all high on methamphetamines and sent them off to their draft interviews higher than four fucking dogs.
Oh my God. The story goes
that like they strip you down, and obviously Iggy Pop is Iggy Pop. So, I mean, he's got a great rock star body, which is also a great soldiering body. So he strips down to his boxers, you know, as he's being told to, and then he puts his hands down inside his pants and holds them there, high on methamphetamines, and then starts yelling, "Nobody's gonna touch my dick! Nobody's touching my dick!" So the soldiers or whoever, like, actually are trying to pull his arms out, but Iggy's a strong guy, so they can't get it out. But they realize, okay, this guy is just a tweaking crazy motherfucker who, for whatever reason, thinks we're about to sexually assault him. So 4F, you're out, Iggy.
Take notes, Iggy, if the draft ever comes back, this is what you're supposed to do. Or it's also how you get out of jury duty, I think.
That's all you say when you're on, nobody's touching my dick. But just like, he's trying to get like more casual about it.
I just like the ideas that people come up with just to act like a fucking crazy fool to get out of jury duty. I'm going to do that one. Like, no one's touching my vagina. ma'am, nobody wants to.
it becomes like a Meisner exercise where you're just trying to come up with different line readings for it.
Yes.
No one is touching my dick. No one is touching my dick.
No one.
No one's touching. No one. Not one is touching my dick.
My dick shall not be touched. I just wanted to say real quick that talking about the squirting the blood, I had a funny story. I used to do doomsday wrestling, which, if you've never seen it, it's dumb. It's like all these characters and we're on stage and
it's fantastic.
It's go comedy. See it. I did it for a few seasons and I was the plague. So my character was this, I was in a wedding dress, but I looked like a zombie, like horrible makeup. And I had like a half mask on that looked like a skull. And my killer move was the kiss of death. And so I was battling Queen Kong, which is this tiny little Asian girl, but she was supposed to be like King Kong. And what I would do is like, it looks like I'm biting her. Like I get her in the corner and I bite her neck really hard. And she pops a blood capsule in my mouth where no one can see. And then I was supposed to jump up on the ropes, crush it in my mouth and just spew blood on the audience. Like that was my
move.
But what happened was popped it in my mouth and then I bit on it and it squirted all back into my throat.
Oh no.
All the blood. And I had set up this photographer telling him like, I'm going to do this move and I want a great, like take a lot of pictures. I want a great shot of me spewing blood into the audience. And it happened and I get up on the ropes and I'm like, like there's no blood because I swallowed all of it. And then I ended up just like biting the ropes like a dog, like I didn't know what to do. It was such a fail. It could have been like one of my great, it would still be my profile picture today had it worked out, but it didn't.
Just imagine like the jaded kid sitting in the back of the club, like, that's the most pathetic spew of blood I've ever seen, man.
It was a scary, I like got actually hurt on that show because right before our match, they had given the audience like Cheetos or cheese puffs and had encouraged them to throw them on stage at the act before us. So when I run and like our fight starts and I run, and I slide onto stage and I get up and I'm shifting my weight back and forth looking at Queen Kong. But in my head, I was freaking out because it had made the whole stage greasy, like chip grease. And I was like,
yeah,
we're going to get hurt. Like I was scared. Mm-hmm. I was like all of our, and so there was one where I have to get clotheslined and I actually fell and I actually like banged my head pretty hard on the thing. And that, I think that was my last performance with them. So I was like, I think I got a mild concussion off of this.
Yeah. I'm done with the Cheeto grease, guys. I'm out of here.
Can't do it.
Diane's done with the Cheeto grease. Cheeto, no more grease. Beating her brains on the wrestling mat.
Is it time for Jeremy?
I think it is time for Jeremy.
Okay, I don't want to rush you if you have more stories, because I know, like we said, there's a lot of stories.
Oh, we have so many more stories, but there's, I mean, I think we've done it. I mean, there's just more. Like, do you want to talk about the time he carved an X into his chest after basically goading a black guy in the audience to stab him for calling him racial epithets?
Yeah, of course I do.
Well, that's basically the story.
That's what happened.
They were at a show. Iggy was high. He was being confrontational with the audience. He bellows to the audience, like, do you want to see some blood? And the audience, of course, says, yeah, we want to see some blood.
Maybe later. Ashton's. No, yeah.
Maybe later. We just started. How about some poop as an appetizer?
Blow bill, please.
So Ronnie Ashton starts whipping him with the you know, one of the cords on the stage, like the mic cord or whatever, and he whips him until he starts bleeding. And that's not enough for the audience. So David Bowie, Iggy Pop's got a steak knife that he brought up on stage just in case, you know, like you do, in case the show sucks a little bit and you need to tear some flesh off the bone to make it up. He sees a black guy in the audience and he starts like heads the knife down, like that's for you. And then he just starts laying into him with the article that I read just said racial epithets. So use your imagination.
So he just
I don't
set
know
him how. Up like, I'm going to make you use this on me.
Yes, it was. He was being that confrontational where he wanted to get, you know, stabbed or attacked by an audience member with a knife. The guy doesn't take the bait. So this is a night that Iggy Pop grabs the knife and starts and carves an X into his own chest. Mm-mm. Like you do. It's so strange when you listen to his interviews today, and he really does seem like the most put together.
So nice.
Yeah, like he's polite. He's just incredibly well structured. He speaks in complete sentences. His vocabulary is amazing. Yeah. And then you hear all of these stories, just like, how did you ever bounce back from being that much of a crazy mess?
I think when you want to be a performer, you can just be whatever you want to be, and you save it for the stage. But that's, I don't even like clipping my nails. Can you imagine dragging a steak knife across your chest?
Yep. That's the only thing I could think of is like he changed his name. He's no longer Jim Osterberg. He's Iggy Pop. Like there, he must have been able to do it.
Compartmentalize.
Yeah, like he was just able to go, no, Iggy did that. Jim is like this. Mm-hmm. And somehow or another, he was able to thread that needle and keep the two personalities separate, so that now he can come out and perform as Iggy and then live the rest of his life as Jim Osterberg, which is unbelievable.
Wow.
Like you think of how many rock stars have tried to do the Iggy Pop thing, either because they saw him do it directly or because it's a natural extension of what rock and roll is. Like, well, let's just get as crazy as fucking possible. He was actually able to.
We mentioned Gigi Allen, and we talked about this on the Gigi Allen episode. Like, if Iggy Pop was the birth of punk rock music, Gigi was the death of it, trying
for
to.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Yeah. He heightened too far. And
yep.
Died.
Yeah, or you could only go like this is exactly where the line is. Like Iggy is probably one of the very few men on the planet who can tell you precisely where the edge is.
Mm-hmm.
Like anybody else who could tell you where the edge is has already gone over it. It's like a famous Hunter Thompson line. Like anybody who tell you where the high side is has gone over it and never lived to tell the tale. Like Iggy's the one guy who's got one of very few, maybe Keith Richards, guys like that, have gone all the way up to the line, looked over the cliff, stared into the abyss, and gone, and I'll walk that down.
No, I'm good. I'm good.
Good.
All right.
Enough.
Let's do it. Let's see how Jeremy Essig connects Iggy Pop to Tommy Stinson.
Hey, friends. Welcome to a movie supergroup laden edition of 6 Degrees, where this week we're going to connect Tommy Stinson to Iggy Pop. And while there are many ways to get to the former Jim Osterberg, the most fun is with Stooges guitarist slash bassist Ron Ashton and his role in the band Wild Rats, a band conceived to make music for the 1998 movie Velvet Goldmine. That group also included Mudhoney's Mark Arm, the Minutemen's Mike Watt, Sonic Youth's Thurston Moore, and Gumball's Don Fleming, the latter two who were also part of the Backbeat Band, which provided music for the Beatles movie of the same name. Backbeat Band drummer Dave Grohl also provided drums on Puff Daddy's Shot Collar Rock remix of All About the Benjamins, a song that featured bass from Tommy Stinson. So this week we went from the Stooges to the Beatles to Puff Daddy, thanks to movies based on David Bowie and the Fab Four. Back to Diana Beth.
That's
amazing.
That took us all around. I love it when they all kind of come back to the Benjamins or the Benjamins thing. And then that was such a fun progression.
Like how I'm starting to see the Tommy Stinson tree of life too, which is like a Dave Grohl, like, I get it now.
I know where we're going. I hope we're all learning. Like the listeners are all starting to be like, we maybe all can get close to doing this now.
Man, there is no way that you can encapsulate the life and legend of Iggy Pop in 1 hour. Like, my hope is that this is just like a starter kit or just a weird 1 hour appreciation of him. But just an incredible performer, just an unbelievable force of nature.
So good. And I'm happy to say, and hopefully I'll still get another chance, but I did get to see him live once. And this was like maybe 20, I think it was right after I got married. So it may have been like 2010. It was like that festival that Houston, the music music festival. And first song he sang was Lust for Life, and he exploded onto the stage. I mean, his energy is whack. It's so good. Mm-hmm. Great, great performance.
Yeah, just charging out, running out, hair all over the place. Of course, shirtless. Yeah.
Yep, no shirt. Mm-hmm. Well, I think we did it. That's Iggy. I'll tell you guys next week. I'm actually excited. Did I tell you what we're doing next week?
What are we doing next week?
It's going to be interesting. So we're going to be joined by the hilarious comedian Brian Garr. And he thought about it. And then he's like, we're going back to 1998 and we're going to do that song, The Way by Fastball. Do you remember that?
I think I do know it.
Where were they going without ever knowing the way? And so we'll save it for the pod. There's a great story behind it. Mm-hmm. Good story.
Yeah, excellent.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to it.
All right.
Let's go carve some letters in our chests. Let's carve a big B in our chest. Are you ready?
Yes.
A bloody boog.
One, two, three.
Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher. Music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees of Tommy Stinson and to Sara Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.